Good morning, brothers and sisters. We hope that you had a good week and are wearing your mask and social distancing. We do ask that you hit the subscribe button so that you will be notified when a new message is released. We thank you once again for tuning in to the Pastor.Faith YouTube channel. We try to bring you in-depth messages using the manuscripts which the King James Bible was originally interpreted from, to give everyone a deeper and clearer view of the Bible. The Bible is a book that was created with the wisdom of God to teach and not to confuse. In the book of James, chapter 1, verse 5 through 6, teaches us, "If any lack wisdom, let him ask of the Lord that giveth to all men liberally." So go with us now into another message, which are recorded at the home church live because of the COVID, and some come straight from the desk of the pastor. Come on and follow us with your Bibles. Amen. When we read our passage today, and it talks about, and this is the Apostle Paul actually talking about what can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. That should be a question that surpasses our mind regularly. With all of the temptations that are out here in this world today, is it strong enough to separate us from the love of God? Or will we stay tacked to what we believe and what we seek to exercise regularly? Now, the title of this message today is Faith. Now, this should be entitled, "What Can Separate Us from the Love of God with Faith?" Because when we look at faith, we look at something that is invisible, hasn't been seen yet, hasn't been experienced yet. And that also can be a need, you know, that we're praying for. We haven't seen the results of it yet, and we haven't experienced it. Now, are we going to let the non-seeing and the non-touching and the non-experience interfere with faith? Is? Because faith is part of everyday living. Now, as we look at the question about what is faith? Faith is complete trust or confidence in someone or something. As we have been going through the Holy Week and the past Sundays, we have seen how faith started, and it started in when Jesus Christ was pronounced to come 1,000 years before he arrived. There were those that had faith. There were the two people that actually waited for him, went in the temple, blessed him. And one person said, "Now I can die because my eyes have seen him." Faith. They had faith waiting all of these years for him to come and for him to be there, that they may touch him, they may feel him. A lot of people experience miracles because they had faith. And when you make up your mind, "I believe," before you see, before you touch, guess what? You're on your way. Me, I believe that when I have the eye surgery, I believe. Do I believe in the surgeons? No. My faith is in the Lord, that He sends His angels to be beside them. They're in there doing this and doing that, and God opens their eyes, or the angel takes their hand and moves it this way a little bit because they are missing something or they're doing too much. My faith is in the Lord to lead and guide them, that they may do what needs to be done, and that I may be a recipient of feeling the results of what is going to come about, not from the doctors, hear me, but from my faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. That is faith. And that's the same thing when I go to have another stent put in. My faith is in the Lord, not them, in the Lord, that He may move in my behalf to lead and guide them and direct them. The sentiment of faith is trust, belief, confidence, conviction, prudence, reliance, and looking for the results. And it continues to be a strong belief in God and in His doctrines based on spiritual apprehension rather than proof. We have a lot of people that are non-believers. We have a lot of people that are religions, atheists, and so on and so forth, that want to have proof for everything. Prove it to me. I've sat down with people and went through scripture and scripture and scripture, scripture. And you know what their response was? Huh. I got to think about this. When you're needing proof of God in any way or fashion, you've got to ask the question, do you really have faith? Because faith, as soon as you hear the word, you're like, wow, that tastes kind of good. I'm going to hang around and see this thing come to pass. And as we look at the faith chapter, which is Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1 through 37, for some of you that take faith lightly, these individuals were in the midst of the fire of life, where Christian existence was not tolerated. If you were heard about being a Christian, heard about believing in the true and the living God, believing that Jesus Christ is His Son, then to them you were a thorn in their flesh, because all they wanted was physical uprise and physical belief in their religion. As we look at the first verse, it says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for the evidence of things not seen. So when we are in need and we need things, we really need to look at asking and believing, which is interpreted as faith, until it comes to pass, that it may at some point in time be visual. Verse 2, for by it the elders obtained a good report. By having faith, they had good reports to spread around about people enduring a lot of things, but their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ delivered them. And if you ask the question, is this a personal thing? Yes, it's a personal thing. I don't expect you to believe what I believe all the time. I don't expect you to see what I'm looking for all the time, but my faith is in the Lord Jesus Christ. to perform what needs to be performed, not man. Through faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God. He spoke it, and it takes faith to believe it. If somebody from some other religion has a form of godliness and denying the power thereof, then they will not believe. The first thing they look at is excuses. But a person that is delegated by God into the Word of God can see and feel that there is some substance in what they're reading. Verse 4, by faith Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain. And when we look at this, we see Abel believed in God. It was in his genes. It was in his DNA. And he just went and did. He had more faith and a better sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous. Cain just got stuff and threw it together. I'm supposed to make a sacrifice because this is the day to do it. He did it and walked away. Where was his faith? It didn't exist. He was just going through the ritual. And you and I will have trials and tests in our life that requires faith. And you know what? We will be tested from time to time where we're at, where we're going, and where our faith is, if it's in God or if it's in man. By faith, Enoch was translated that he should not see death, and he was not found because God had translated him. Now, before this actually happened, he had heard that he might be translated. And you know what? He believed and he waited. He went through each day waiting for the translation to take place. And it did. Verse 6, but without faith it is impossible to please him, for he that cometh to God must believe that he is. It's impossible. Did you hear that? It's impossible to please him at all if you don't have faith. So what is it saying basically? Yeah, you've heard about God. You've heard testimonies, some witnessing through other people. But it is impossible to please God if you don't have faith. In the Bible, they asked one man if he believed. You know what his response was? I believe, but helpeth thou my belief, my unbelief. What was he saying? I'm not quite there yet. I can't acknowledge that this is an existence that is true, but help me to fully understand that my faith will increase. He that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligent seek him. This is not no halfway journey here where you just do whatever you want to do, when you want to do, and just hope it all falls in line. No, we have the word of God here. There's no excuse. You got to pick it up. You got to read it. And as I've said so many times, and I've prayed for this for decades, when the internet came out, I prayed to God that they would receive the Christian doctrine and that it would be exposed all over the internet, all over the world, that people would not have an excuse not to study the Word of God and be influenced by it. Don't get me wrong. Some of the things that are on there is questionable, but you ask God by the leading of the Spirit to interpret and show you what is right and what is not. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. You can't get around it. And faith is going to show in your works, how you carry yourself, because when you get in conversations with people and things come up, you're automatically going to respond like this. And they're going to turn around and look, and it's going to be a godly mode and a method that you're going to respond, which is going to get their attention. Verse 7, by faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear and prepared an ark to the saving of his house. Now, I want you to really think about that. Embed your mind into this. At that time, the earth was filled with just all kinds of corrupt people going against everything that Noah was doing, his life, his family. But yet, when Noah heard God, he knew that it was from God, and his faith believed in God. Noah had faith in what he heard from God, and he began to work. And it was just him and his family. Remember that. Building this ark. And everybody's coming around making fun of him and everything else. It hadn't rained in years. Why is it going to rain now? Noah just kept working. His sons, his daughters, daughter-in-laws, they kept working. They kept working because he had faith in what he heard from God. Here we go. By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should after receive for an inheritance, obeyed. Okay. I heard from you, Lord. I believe what I heard. And I'm ready to go. And he went out, not knowing where he was going. He had no idea. He didn't even know what was outside of the boundaries of the country that he was living in. But by faith, he left his heathen relatives and the heathen nation with no knowledge of the land. And we're talking this morning about the demonstration of faith and the illustration of faith from those that went before us. And they, I feel, endured much more than we did. Verse 9, by faith, he sojourned in the land of promise as a strange country. Here you go. He knew nothing. He didn't know where he was going. But his faith said, I will be led by the Spirit. Through faith, verse 11, also, Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed and was delivered of a child when she was past age. Just remember, she's 90 or more, and it would be troublesome for her to become pregnant and then push the baby out with being that weak at that age. But because she judged him faithful who had promised. Now, that was after her shenanigans. Well, by telling Abraham, I'll take my handmaid and we'll have a seed by her, through her. That's not what God said. But once she got her scruples, her spiritual scruples in order, then she believed. She judged him faithful who had promised. By faith, Abraham, when he tried, offered up Isaac, and he that had received the promise offered up his only begotten son. What is this? This is a relegate of what God did. He offered up his only begotten son. Now, we see Abraham, once he got his son, he was tested to see if he loved his son more than he loved God. Now, many of us ask for things, and when God brings them to us, you know, that then there's a test sometime to see if you love that more than you love God. Because here's how we'll know. Because you will not waver. Your faith will not waver. You'll continue to walk with God. You'll continue to do what God has called you to do, regardless of the blessings that has been bestowed upon you. Your walk never wavers with God. You just keep right on and right on. Where many have leaned toward the blessing, and now the blessing is controlling them. By faith, Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau concerning things to come. By faith, Jacob, when he was dying, blessed both the sons of Joseph and worship, leaning upon the top of his staff, which was Ephraim and Manasseh. Excuse me. By faith, Moses, when he was born, was hid 3 months of his parents because they saw he was a proper child. What do you mean by a proper child? That was a child that was called of God to be something. And they were not afraid of the king's command. In other words, they saw the anointing of God on Moses' life. And they had faith that if they took him properly and put him in a handmade little sailboat or a cradle and put him in the water, that someone would find him. And it all worked out very well. Pharaoh's daughter found him and then hired Moses' mom to raise him and take care of him. That's faith. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell down after they were compassed about 7 days. These were huge walls. These were walls that protected the enemy. You can't get through with those high walls. But faith drove the believers into completing the Lord's tireless command. What did he tell them? To walk around it 7 times. And they walked around it. And then they blew the trumpets. And the walls fell. It didn't fall by them. It fell by their faith that they had in God. And God came down from heaven and struck those walls and knocked them down. By faith, and this is a misinterpretation for all of you. It says, by faith, harlot Rahab perished. If she was not, when you do the research on her life, she was not a harlot. She was one that made fine clothes, and they labeled her as a harlot because of her success. She made the finest clothes in the country. But she perished not with them that believe not, because she was amongst all unbelievers. And when she had received the spies, which the spies was who Joshua sent to spy out the city to see what they were and if they could take them. And she took these spies and hid them when the guards came around and checked out all the areas and make sure no one got in, because they suspected somebody broke in. And she hid them in the flax. The flax were all of her supplies that she had for making fine clothing. But her faith sustained her when they actually came to destroy the city. They told her before she left to hang this particular clothing out. I believe it was red. And when all of our people come to see it, they'll go around it and not touch anybody there. Faith, faith. Hebrews 11:32. And what shall I more say? This is Paul writing. For the time would fail me to tell Gideon and Barak and of Samson and of Jephthah, of David also and Samuel and of the prophets. In other words, there's more to add to this about people that had a high standard of faith. Say high standard of faith. Who, verse 33, who through faith subdued kingdoms, fought against them who fought against them, basically is what this is saying, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, Stop the mouths of lions. And when it says stop the mouths of lions, the first thought comes to your mind is David, because he was guarding his sheep and he stopped the mouths of a lot of lions and bears and things of that nature. It was his faith in his God. Verse 34, they quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, out of the weakness were made strong, waxed valiant in fight, turned to flight the armies of the aliens, which is foreigners. And when I think about when it says about escape the edge of the sword and out of weakness were strong, waxed valiant in fight, I think of David. Because David slew at one time thousands of people, and he only had a ragtag army of 600. It was his faith in his God that drove him to believing and knowing that victory would come his way, even though he had not yet saw it. Women received their dead raised to life again, and others were tortured, not accepting deliverance, that they might obtain a better resurrection. Some had faith to die and be in the presence of their Lord and God and not give up their faith in their belief. And others had trial of cruel mockery, scourging, they were whipped. Yea, moreover, of bonds and imprisonment. They were stoned. They were sawn asunder. In other words, they were put in a log, and they were sawed. The log was sawed right through, and it sawed them right in half and killed them. They were tempted, were slain with the sword. They wandered about in sheepskin and goatskin, being destitute. And the thing of it is, brothers and sisters, they had, many of them had an opportunity to run. But they stood up against the enemy in the name of the Lord God and in the name of Jesus Christ. They stood and they would not back down in their belief. You know what? We in the United States have not experienced that yet. But there's many that are in third world countries that die regularly because of their belief. They're taken right out in the street and they're slain right in the middle of the city, right before the people, to let them know, don't try this again. Excuse me. And if you remember the story about the woman that believed in the Lord Jesus Christ and didn't want to follow her religious belief, and she was told by her brother, you better change the way you think or you'll be killed. And she walked right up to him and said, I refuse to change the way I believe, because I believe in the true and the living God and that he is the only way. He personally went out and grabbed her and dragged her out in the street and killed her right before the people, just because she would not believe. And as I said before, I'll say it again, we have not seen the severity of faith being tempted, being challenged by the adversary yet, like some of these third world countries that have one large religion, and you better bow down before that or you will be slain. They wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute. In other words, wandering around without food, without clothing, without shelter, not having the proper necessities to survive, this is saying. Afflicted and tormented. Again, you and I have not been challenged against our religion about how we believe by having our clothing taken away, having our shelter taken away, and not being able to buy food. So I say to you, think about the power of faith. And if your faith is not where it needs to be, brothers and sisters, ask the Lord to increase your faith by challenging you through the Word of God. And you've got to read the Word of God or you're not going to learn anything. You could easily get on the web, get on the internet and you can type in the browser how to increase scriptures to increase my faith. And you'll get a list of them right there. And you can go and read through them. So anybody that doesn't know, there won't be excuse when you stand before the Lord, because the tools that the world uses are available for you to use to increase your wisdom and your knowledge of faith in Jesus Christ. Amen. Father, today we honor you once again and we thank you for the words of wisdom and of knowledge that you continue to pour down upon us, letting us know that you still are Lord of Lords and King of Kings, and that there is an answer to every situation. And I ask you to touch us and let us begin to take you more serious than we have in the past, to be able to receive you as Lord and Savior, and then strive to become better sons and daughters unto you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for joining us on the Pastor.Faith YouTube channel. We encourage you to have a conversation with God on a daily basis. Not many people take the time out of their schedule to do so. This ministry encourages everyone to receive Jesus Christ into their life as Lord and Savior. You may ask, how do I receive him? Just talk to him, confessing to him as being a sinner and how much you need his help. Asking Jesus into your heart, which is your mind, and in doing so, we then have a covenant with God that when we repent and ask for forgiveness for any of our sins, any time of the day, any hour of the day, that we all commit regularly, God is justified to forgive us of our sins. Let me say, the most challenging moment through this process you will face is receiving that forgiveness. You may not feel comfortable the first time around, but practice makes perfect. Feel free to forgive yourself, knowing that someone loves you deeply as God Almighty. He himself has proven it all by bringing his only begotten Son to take on all our sins as the last sacrifice for mankind, to absorb all of the sins of mankind that we all commit, and still having the power to forgive us. We love you and look forward to meeting you and sharing the next message. Hey, don't forget to hit the subscribe button to be notified when the next message is released and posted. God bless you. Till next time. His holy name.
Bless his holy, bless his holy, his wonderful, wonderful name. He's brought us from a long, long way. Bless his holy name.